I'm full-time eco-chaplain with the movement of around 600 congregations, colleges and Christian communities of all sorts, which makes up Eco Congregation Scotland. But visiting churches as eco-chaplain, I can confirm that the endearingly understated vision of Christian character, which Jesus called children of the light, is alive and well. The ones who never dare rock the boat, never dream of breaking even the most unjust of laws. Jesus sent his apostles out like sheep among wolves, needing to keep their wits about them, needing to be as harmless as pigeons or doves, but also as crafty as snakes. Not the other way around. Children of light are the ones who piously tone down the earthiness of what Jesus comes out with to keep his speech tasteful and dignified and understated. And perhaps for a while, they manage to keep a lid on it.
Hypocrite. Snake. Dog. Pig. Hypocrite. Fox. Hypocrite. Whitewashed tombs. Hypocrite.
But now, in the climate crisis, the stones are shouting aloud. Can you add your voice and give the stones a break? Maybe, or just join them. Though this job is full-time, I'm not a specialist. I have no formal qualifications beyond those of every general practice pastoral leader, which is why I'm confident that within your church, the job I'm trying to do and encourage can be picked up and run with by anyone in any local situation to whom we can give sufficient encouragement to trust the science and trust the gifts of their own church in responsible study and discernment. But I also know that this takes courage, and courage takes the support of a community. To some extent, that's what Eco Congregation Scotland offers. A leader cannot lead without that foundation. Reading the signs of the times and trusting in the visionary guidance of the Holy Spirit, those things happen in community. A community who is recycling, repurposing, not just reusing, what are previously multiply recycled resources of our faith. Taking note and faithfully responding in prayer, in worship and in action to the state of the world, that is a continuity, not a departure from Christian tradition and faithfulness. And that's not to be confused with being conformed to the world, which is another way of saying be harmless, useless, be quiet when you should speak out and rock the boat, just be decorative on great state occasions and never, never, ever mix religion and politics. Tick all those boxes, you'll be completely conformed to the entitled global economic system, which likes to think it's all the world that matters. And moral authority, which churches and faith groups do offer, they like to keep that as a toothless myth. Don't confuse that world with the living earth that God so loves, that God sent God's only child, that those who trust might not be lost, nor God's beloved world lost neither. As for the faithful task of recycling the church, of digging out the green pearls of great price from the field of our lives today, we live in very different times from those in which some of the best-loved commentaries and translations of the Bible were written. Yes, they dug out plenty that we still build with and enjoy, but your own reflections and observations today, your faithful and prayerful recycling of what they recycled, are what matter, what you do. Those climate conversations with sisters and brothers in faith, the mutual encouragement rather than being overawed by the printed word or the big name religious writer who did their best and made a difference, but knew far less than you do about climate change and the injustice which causes it. Honour them by recycling them. Environmentalists and protesters like to talk about and paint banners about there's no planet B. I disagree. We're already on planet B, along with the old normal before lockdown. The planet we hark back to is gone. So how do we both face and tell the alarming truth compellingly enough so that people take what action they can before too many tipping points are passed, even if they are? How do we get the message across without exaggeration that damage is already done? Did you get it in July's heatwave? How not to panic when we take it in that climate crisis is with us for the rest of our lives? Though famously, according to Greta Thunberg, panic has its place because it gets us moving. Though panic, like lament, is no way to spend your life, but rather like anger, it's something on which we need not let the sun go down. Panic, lament, and anger have their place because they move us on. They move us on to Hosanna, that joyful cry for help, that cry that says, God, this is wrong. God, where do we go from here? Now, allowing for the measures I've taken to protect myself against midges in this managed wilderness, as when I visit Scottish islands, I can breathe without an inhaler. In the cities, it's more difficult. Though Jeremiah records the tears for the slain of my people, how dry would our eyes be over the casualties of polluted air, which even in the UK shortens tens of thousands of lives each year, or for the victims of those unprecedented droughts, floods, heat waves, and more than previously frequent extreme weather already affecting most of the world. You see, we allow our culture to present it as if it had no cause. Even in the UK, heat waves are the deadliest extreme weather event, with, until now, 2,000 heat-related deaths every year, according to the Met Office. How do we not weep with those who weep over the fact that a good 20% of the GDP of some nations already goes on the mitigation of the ravages of climate change? And if that was the UK, we'd be talking 500 billion. This does have causes. And following Jeremiah's diagnosis, those causes are spiritual realities. This is recognised internationally by churches and other faith groups. And as for the worship of foreign idols, read every continuing determination to put profit before planet and the cult of single use, throwaway, of endless growth, blocking reuse and transition with scare stories about the upfront cost of change rather than the hidden cost of a continuing suicidal war on nature. That's why the parable of the steward of unjust wealth is such a gift for preaching in the season of creation. The children of the light just don't get this one because there is no way it can be made entirely respectable. When I preached on this in my first year of ministry, the ladies' fellowship demanded a Bible study because they said, Jesus cannot possibly have said that. The parable also highlights the very limited meaning of the word steward. Someone who deals with inanimate objects rather than working in partnership with fellow creatures and the living earth of which we are part. Stewardship Christianity, that comfortable, tasteful tendency of recent years, is no longer fit for purpose, allowing as it does the detached continuation of our treating all life like soulless commodity or property which has been signed over entirely to our species rather than embracing a consultative partnership with the earth. Stewardship is a slippery slope to what the militant indigenous people at COP would call
the commodification of nature.
There are far more interactive, consultative images in the Bible for our calling to partnership with a living and sentient creation than stewardship, which has its roots in a Reformation idea of Haushalterschaft. It had a great attraction for children of the light in churches because it sounded like a tasteful, understated alternative to dominion in King James, and that became a slippery slope to domination. But after the climate conferences of Rio, of Paris, and of course on our doorstep with Glasgow in COP26, after Pope Francis's recycling of St. Francis's vision of the earth as a beloved relative who also governs it, after all that, we need something more nourishing and more dangerous. For some of you, this will be the first time you've heard stewardship challenged as the default, obligatory, go-to way to talk about creation. But at this year's European Churches Environmental Network, there was wide consensus yet again that stewardship was no longer a viable image for our place in the care of creation. Be that as it may, over and above any particular words and turns of phrase, what I am compelled to be getting at is firstly that just falling back on the last but one cycle of our recycling of faith is no way to face life on an earth under a heaven which is objectively redefined by so many signs without precedent in thousands or even millions of years. Faithful people are those who keep on praying, discerning, asking what the Spirit is saying to the churches today. And that frees us to value this parable in its own terms. Is this the sort of stewardship we really are called to, this desperate, lovable rogue rather than a grim rule keeper who collaborates with oppression and environmental disaster? This story is a gift for our day because it has Jesus's characteristic admonition to the understated children of light to reclaim craftiness as a gospel virtue, to be mischievous for Christ. And this description of the wealth that the steward or manager has charge of is set in perspective as a negotiable means to the purpose, to the end of fellowship and hospitality. So wealth, when expressed as money, may be inanimate, but it's not neutral. Nonetheless, George MacLeod, as a Christian visionary, broken by the experience of war, reclaimed the craftiness of the steward. He exploited funding from makers of warships to rebuild the stones of Iona Abbey and found a community deeply committed to Christian peacemaking. George openly spoke of making dirty money clean, but that takes complete honesty about the harm it can do. In Shetland, it's oil money that has set up the Lerwick District Heating Scheme. It's a network of pipes which now, at a fraction of the cost of mainstream energy, pumps low-carbon heat from the town's incinerator to churches, businesses and homes. It even picks up what would be wasted heat from the existing fossil fuel-powered power station. And since it doesn't matter technically where the heat comes from, there's scope in the future for heat exchange too. And yes, incineration may not be ideal, but combined with an ever stricter commitment to recycle what can be recycled, and mindful of the carbon cost of landfill, here's that steward of unjust wealth in a commendable project, which is going to be of enormous benefit to that community as standard energy prices soar and fuel poverty kicks in elsewhere, scarcely hindered by those fuel subsidies which head straight back into the pockets of energy companies. And do not assume that the wealthy master in the parable is God. The closest we've got to meeting God face to face is in a poor, possibly redundant carpenter. This master is a predator. He's not bothered whether the reports of dishonesty are true. The mere accusation is enough for him to yell, "You're fired." What does Jesus mean when he talks about faithfulness with dishonest wealth? If the right master to serve exclusively is God, then this desperate and crafty generosity, which liberates from hardship and benefits others too, that may be faithfulness to the God who values God's people, God's creatures, and God's planet. But remember how clearly this is put by Jesus, that though you can use money in God's cause, you really cannot serve both God and money.